The Liskov Substitution Principle is an eternal source of confusion, but also debate among programmers of all ages and seniority levels. And I know why it is so. I'll show you now. Consider implementing a stack. That is a common exercise in programming books when you learn principles such as LSP. LSP is about behavioral subtyping, so I will also implement a stack which is supposed to only contain unique items. I know of programmers who readily testify that this system of types is violating the LSP. It is not, at least not yet. In this video, I will show you how LSP works on derived classes, but also on classes that implement an interface. LSP applies both to subclassing and to interface implementation in the same way. LSP is augmenting the object substitution principle, which is a fundamental principle. It guarantees that a method will exist on any implementation that derives, directly or indirectly, from the variable type on the left, the variable to which I have assigned a reference to an object. However, the object substitution principle is not sufficient. Popping off an empty stack here looks to me like an imminent exception. Enter the Liskov substitution principle. It doesn't mention behavior, it doesn't mention classes, interfaces, nothing. It just speaks in terms of properties that we can check. If the property holds on an object of the base type, it must also hold on any other object we might substitute in its place. Here is an example. A non-empty stack can pop off an item. This is one property that must hold on anything if we wanted to consider it a stack. I cannot prove these stacks are non-empty, so LSP has already indicated to me that these calls are not safe. Another abstract property will help. It is that push leaves the stack non-empty. Now I see that if I push an item first, the stack will become non-empty, and then popping an item off of it will become safe. This is how LSP is helping me. I have just proven that this code will never fail. I have prepared a generic static class to help me test LSP in classes. This is the type of the reference to which variables will be assigned, and the test will assign instances of the other two types to it. I may employ the using static directive to access static methods directly, so I can start writing those abstract properties that must be satisfied by both types I have implemented so far. The first abstract property is that push leaves the stack non-empty. The action I make is to push a number onto the stack. And the Boolean property to verify is that the count property is now greater than zero. The next property was that pop succeeds on a non-empty stack. Testing whether pop succeeded will require some imagination. Look at this. I don't test the return value. It's very important. I'm writing abstract properties. This one says that pop will succeed. It doesn't say what it will return, but it will succeed. So I'm expecting a value back. I don't care what value, but it must be there. This is how I test an abstract property. A few corner cases come next. I also want these stacks to exhibit the LIFO order, with the last item pushed coming out first. Now, this list of properties is not exhaustive. Do you know which properties are missing? We will come to them in a few minutes. Figuring out the missing parts here will teach you a good lesson about LSP. I will now implement the two stack classes. The stack might hold items in a list, making count trivial. Push will add items at the back of the list. These operations are very fast on the list class. But pop will be more interesting. I will throw on an empty stack. Does this implementation violate LSP? Does throwing an exception violate LSP? You will be thinking about that question even after you watch this video, so try to answer that question for yourself. I will also implement the unenumerable interface returning content from top to bottom. And that's it. I will run the tests, and you will now witness that this implementation satisfies all the properties I have listed. I shall now step to the unique stack class, where I need to override some behavior, trying not to break any of these properties that are working fine right now. I must override the push method, that is the difference between the unique stack and the common one. This helper method will nail it down. If the base says it contains an item, then quit. The public method will subject all the items to this helper method, and now you will tell me straight, did I break the Liskov principle with this implementation? There is no other way to check it out but to run those Boolean predicates and see. It appears I didn't break LSP. On the other hand, deep inside, you will know that something is wrong here. I cannot just drop items from a stack and still call it a stack. Something is wrong here. How can I prove that something is wrong here? All right, let me unveil that mystery. LSP is closely related to unit tests. Each of these properties could be a unit test. And if I was writing unit tests, I would certainly see that the last one is not complete. There are more test cases to check here. I can push three values first, then pop the last one. That should create a stack with values 1 and 2, right? I want this property to also be true in both base and derived class. Liskov principle says they must be. But they won't be, you see already. Okay, more properties will outline other violations of the LSP. Okay, running the tests, they will identify the issues. All right. Two predicates, or two unit tests if you like, are failing now. The unique stack has even crashed in one case. Oh, that is a disaster. That is a full technical answer to the question, does the unique stack break LSP? Yes, it does, because it doesn't have certain properties that the base stack has. Worse yet, the unique stack variant, as I have envisioned it here, is beyond repair. I really have no idea how to implement such a class without breaking at least one of those properties. So, I have failed in this attempt, but I can get up again. The demo is not over yet. The Liskov principle is one of the solid principles, which means that not only that you can apply it to analyze code and make certain observations on it, but you can also use LSP to construct code. You can build a model with LSP in mind. This time, we define abstract properties on an interface. And every class implementing that interface must satisfy those properties. So the rules of engagement are exactly the same as they were when I was working just with classes. The difference is that now you could have only one class and one interface. But still, those are essentially two types, because you can assign an object of the class to a reference to the interface. The interface defines the properties and the class must satisfy them. Let's see how that works. So I will create an interface called stackable. It would specify all those members, but their properties would be the mild ones, those that are not so rigid. Now, the second interface. It will inherit from it, but add no members at all. How come? That is LSP at work. I have defined a new interface with no new members at all. It doesn't change the signatures of anything, but it adds more properties the parent interface didn't have. Okay, there will be two classes, this time not deriving from one another, but implementing the interfaces. Do you see how the climate is gradually changing when I use LSP to drive my design? If you don't see my point here, if you don't see why I'm doing it this way, then you are still not seeing the Liskov principle well. But don't worry, there is still time to figure it out. The two interfaces define two groups of properties. We observe some properties when accessing an object through the iStackable interface. We observe additional properties when accessing an object through the iStackProper interface. I'm also using type aliases from C# 12 here to make my code more compact. Okay, let's quickly define the properties of these two interfaces. Any stackable must be non-empty following a call to push. A call to pop must always succeed on a non-empty stackable object. But its LIFO behavior is dubious. I will go with a less stringent definition of LIFO. I will lower the bar and say that a stackable structure only guarantees that the last item will come out first. This ends the definition of stackable. I will be talking to a proper stack further on. This structure must satisfy the strict LIFO order for all items. Just stackable didn't have this requirement. We also expected the proper stack to grow by one item on push and shrink by one item on pop. I can step down to implement the two concrete classes. You can do this in 100 ways. This is one. Don't judge me. Here is my point. I have unit tests, I have properties that are being checked, Boolean properties, that say whether this implementation is satisfying the requirements of the stack or not. Try to understand it this way. If the properties are true, there is no quarrel between you and me about this implementation, all right? If you had anything against this implementation, then you should say which Boolean property that is. I have nothing against adding more Boolean properties to that list. But please, you must be specific about that, not just giving me opinionated views about my code, or vice versa. I should not make opinionated judgments about your code as well. Now that we have got that straight, I'll give you the implementation of the other class, the stackable, the unique stack. I'm giving you this remarkable solution that will raise your eyebrows, but calm down, we had a deal, didn't we? Don't judge this implementation, the LSP will judge it. Look here. It says I'm right. Let me spare a moment to discuss these findings. There are two interfaces, two classes, and two sets of properties defined by the LSP or aligned with LSP. The second interface derives or inherits the first one, and so the second group of properties is an extension to the first group of properties. Here is the point. The unique stack only implements the base interface, and so it needs to satisfy the first group of properties only. But the second class, stack, is implementing the derived interface, so it inherits the properties of the base interface plus more properties defined on the second, the derived interface. And so the stack must satisfy all these Boolean properties. Not a single one may be missing. Do you see it now? That is how derivation behaves. It's actually adding more conditions the class must satisfy, more predicates, more Boolean tests it must pass. This is the end of the demo. This is the system of types that doesn't break the Liskov principle. And in the end, as I promised, I was successful implementing that unique stack, which sounds crazy, which sounds like impossible. But it is possible if you can find a proper definition which it satisfies. I hope this demo will help you not make silly mistakes in the future when you discuss the Liskov principle with your colleagues and friends.